Welcome to Dig on America, where we speak truth to power. Every week, we give you the dig on how American history, policies, and media created the social and political issues we face today. DOA is independent media supported by listeners, but they'll tell you we're just fake news, deep state propaganda, funded by George Soros, the Clinton Foundation, BLM Marxists, and...
Quasimoto.
Liza Minnelli.
Cortez Branch.
I mean, can I just pick Danny DeVito and be happy?
Yeah, you can pick Danny DeVito. Danny DeVito, you actually got it right. He is actually truly a patron of the show for 1 cent a month. Welcome back, everyone, to Dig on America. This is Jason Dutch, and I am here with Mikey Famine to my, well, depends on which way you're looking at the screen. and below me.
Below you.
See how we get on Kwanzaa below, of all days.
Below me, Cortez. No. And special guest of the show is empowered black man, Cortez Brisnanch. What's up, buddy?
How you guys doing tonight?
Hello.
Oh, we're doing all right. So forgive Cortez a little background noise, but you know, that's because Patreon has not sent us enough money for us to buy him a microphone before we came on here. But he's smart enough and intelligent enough and gosh darn it, interesting like enough him. And gosh darn it, people like him that you need to get over that slight little background noise that you hear. Because today we're going to teach and discuss and explore the history of Kwanzaa. For the sake of the viewing audience, we'll get to the dig on Kwanzaa. So let's jump into that right away. And we got a couple other things to talk about afterwards in the second hour of the show. Thank you to Anne-Marie Danimas for coming on for the first half of the show. If you're listening to this show on audio and you want to hear the from Anne-Marie Danimas, who is a progressive candidate in Washington State, Washington 5, it'll be one episode down on Spotify or iTunes or whatever your listening app, podcast app of choice happens to be. So with that being said, let's take it back with this week's dig. Now, my eighth grade social studies teacher,
Mr. Humble,
taught me things that turns out after doing my own research wasn't always the whole story. And this week, we will dive into the topic of Kwanzaa. What the heck is Kwanzaa? No one knows what this is. So often the butt of jokes, but we'll find out maybe it should be, maybe it shouldn't be in a few seconds. Kwanzaa is an annual week-long celebration running from December 26th to New Year's Day that honors Black history and culture. It celebrates seven values in African culture: unity, self-determination, collective responsibility.
Pause. I want the African names.
Yeah, they're coming up later, so okay. Calm down. Cooperative economics, purpose, creativity, and faith. No, Kwanzaa has nothing to do with Wakanda. So just take that out of your vocabulary.
You don't know that.
All right, you're right. It's a Wakandan holiday.
Thank you.
Kwanzaa began in 1966 when Dr. T'Challa, I'm sorry, that is not true. When Dr.
Killmonger,
Dr. Malana Karanga, and I hope I'm pronouncing that right. It's Malanakaranga, a professor of African studies in the wake of social unrest in Watts in the 60s. The holiday represents family, culture, and heritage, and much like the pagan festivals that were amalgamated into Christmas, Kwanzaa was modeled after various African solstice and harvest celebrations. For Karanga, a major figure in the Black Power movement in the 1960s and 70s, the creation of such holidays also underscored the essential premise that, quote, you must have a cultural revolution before you can have any violent revolution. The cultural revolution gives identity, purpose, and direction, end quote. According to Karenga, who was a member of the Black Power movement, the name Kwanzaa derives from the Swahili phrase Matunda ya Kwanzaa, meaning first fruits. And I, again, I'm mispronouncing shit is my thing. So
Harambe.
Harambe. Harambe. Hakuna Matata. No, it's not Hakuna Matata. It's Matunda ya Kwanzaa. Matunda ya Kwanzaa. Oh, what a wonderful phrase.
Thank you, Sim, for remembering the bit.
First fruits. Now, Matunda ya Kwanzaa was a first fruit festival. So similar to a lot of the Norse and Germanic festivals we talked about last week on the Dig on Christmas. These festivals are very prevalent in South and Southern Africa and celebrated in December and January, along with coordination with the Southern Solstice. And Karenga was partly inspired by an account he read from the Zulu festival. This is a doozy. Apparently my audio is off a little bit. Umkhahasi Wokweshwama. It was decided to spell the holiday's name with an additional A, because the phrase I said before only had one A. And that extra A was added.
Can you put that gentleman's name in the private chat and I'll try and read it? That's the good thing about like African names is they're very phonetic and every single letter is pronounced.
Yes, I spelled it for you, but I will be happy to do that.
No. The guy with the like 14 syllable name, you just said it. You didn't spell it.
Oh no, that wasn't a person. That was a Zulu festival. So the Zulu festival, I am pronouncing it as Umkhahasi Wokweshwama. I'm going to actually give Mikey a chance here to try to grammar check me on that. What do you think, Mikey? What do you think of that pronunciation?
I'm going to rate you at about a C minus there.
Yeah. Gosh.
So you go for it, smart guy.
It's the first one is three syllables. It's Umkhosi. And then it looks like woe is a syllable, kwe, and then shwama.
Yeah, I pronounce it as Umkhosi Wokweshwama. So
a couple of extra H's in there, but this is pretty good.
You get a B plus for that.
Hey, one. White Wolf. Not bad, White Wolf. We'll let you keep your arm this month.
Where's the fight?
Bonde River, but you could definitely pronounce that a little better.
I got it. Just let me know where there's a fight. It's on its way. Okay, so again, Karenga decided to spell the holiday's name with an additional A so that it would be symbolic and have the same seven letters as the seven principles we'll talk about in a second. It's a celebration that uses the time of winter harvest to allow its celebrants to reevaluate their lives and reset for the new year. Journalist Therese Nelson said of the Kwanzaa, it's a holiday designed to meet its participants wherever they are on the cultural spectrum. In the early years of Kwanzaa, Karenga said it was meant to be an alternative to Christmas, believing Christianity was a white religion that black people should shun. The first Hallmark card for the holiday went to market in 1992, commercialized. And the first Kwanzaa stamp was introduced by the United States Post Office in 1997. That same year, Bill Clinton gave the first presidential declaration marking the holiday. As Kwanzaa gained mainstream adherence in the 1990s, Karenga reversed his position so that practicing Christians would not be alienated, stating in his book, Kwanzaa, A Celebration of Family, Community, and Culture, which was also released in 1997, quote, Kwanzaa was not created to give people an alternative to their own religion or religious holiday. Many African Americans who celebrate Kwanzaa do so in addition to observing Christmas. So let's talk about those seven principles. Number one, and this is spelled UMOJA, Umoja, means unity, to strive for and maintain unity in the family, community, nation, and race. This one is another real doozy. So I will post this one here as well for my friends to give their opinion on the pronunciation of this. It's K-U-J-I-C-H-A-G-U-L-I-A. I'm going to say it's Kujichagulia. Kujichagulia.
That's not bad.
Okay. Means self-determination, to define ourselves, name ourselves, create for ourselves, and speak for ourselves. Ujima, U-J-I-M-A, means collective work and responsibility, to build and maintain our community together and make our brothers and sisters' problems our problems, and to solve them together. Ujamaa, which is different from Ujima, U-J-A-M-A-A, means cooperative economics, to build and maintain.
Can't have them cooperative economics now. Hold on.
No, sir. It's dangerous.
You better stop.
To build and maintain our own stores, our own shops, and other businesses, and to profit from them together. It's dangerous talk. Sarcasm. Nia. N-I-A means purpose. Not to be like confused with Nia Long, but probably Nia where her Long. Name came from. Yeah. To make our collective vocation the building and developing of our community. Kumba. K-U-U-M-B-A. Not to be confused with the vacuum cleaner. Means creativity. To leave our community more beautiful than we inherited it. And finally, seventh, Imani. I-M-A-N-I means faith, to believe with all our hearts in our people, our parents, our teachers, our leaders, and the righteousness and victory of our struggle. Each of the seven candles on the Kanara, the candle holder, signifies these principles. The Kanara has three red candles on the left, three green candles on the right, and one black candle in the center. The black candle, which represents unity, is the first. Then lighting alternates between the red and green candles, beginning on the outside of the Kanara and moving back inward per the holiday spot. One candle is lit per day of the celebration. These candle colors symbolize the holiday's people, black in the middle, African ancestry, red, and Africa's rich land, green. They can also symbolize, some other sources say some different information. For example, PBS says they also symbolize the struggle, red, and the hope, green. Finally, there is a feast on the Big Bash on the last night of Kwanzaa, December 31st, New Year's Eve, called Karamu, K-A-R-A-M-U. Again, mispronouncing things is my thing. On that day of the Karamu feast, observers come together to honor the renewal, re-education, and resilience that Kwanzaa symbolizes. In closing, author Jessica B. Harris writes, "I savor the ways in which the feast allows for a transmission of history and culture. How youngsters sit and listen to their elders talk of their pasts and the history that binds us all." So there is your dig on Kwanzaa. No jokes about it on this one, though. I do. The only comedian I remember was...
I got a joke for you. I got a joke for you. You're not ready for this. I didn't tell you about this because I think it's funnier when I expose you to things live on the air. Your girlfriend... Hold on. God bless it. Share this one.
Exposing the business.
This one right meow. Let me zoom in for you. So the College Republicans, CR at CRNC, wishing you a happy and prosperous Kwanzaa. And he spelled it wrong. And the little picture is wrong. Happy Kwanzaa, they say. But your girl, MT Green, says stop. It's a fake religion created by a psychopath. You aren't bringing in new voters. You are turning them away. People are tired of pandering. And BS says your snap one, Mary one snap.
MTG, as they call her.
Yeah, that's what her say. Her say that this is all a fake religion created by a psychopath.
You know, that might be fun. While I'm looking this up, your thoughts on the dig, Cortez, because that's why you're here.
Well, I mean,
you're nominated to represent Kwanzaa for the entire African American community.
That's why. So, you know, he gave you guys pretty much the background of Kwanzaa, and you know why Kwanzaa was created, why Kwanzaa is celebrated, and what it stands for. Kwanzaa was one of those things that came about in the 60s when people were all about creating a new hope and being able to build society the way that society should be built. You know, society, and this is going to anger some people, but I do think that, you know, the African-American, the Pan-African community as in the world needs to be independent in a lot of ways. And I think that they can't ask for someone else to build something for them. And yeah, we can say that, you know, we build things and they get destroyed all the time. Look at what happened in Tulsa. You know, I'm still talking about what happened in Philadelphia in the 80s. In the
80s. Chicago, St. Louis.
You know, Chicago, St. Louis, Detroit.
Wichita.
You know, Southern California, you know, Compton. You know, Arkansas. You know, we can do this all day. North Carolina. We can do this all day because this has been happening for, you know, over 100 years. And I think that Kwanzaa was a way to, you know, start stepping away from the dependence that was, you know, fostered over, you know, a century plus of people being told that they've got nothing. They are nothing. They came from nowhere. And it's a way to kind of take back and say, okay, well, we're not going to have, you know, an ancient belief system, you know, that tells us how to be. It's going to be built on principles. It's going to be built on values. It's going to be built on love. It's going to be built on family. It's going to be built on progression. And, you know, what's funny about that is that's supposed to be why this country was created. So people who are talking about people don't have values when they celebrate something like this, it's kind of offensive because this is supposed to be those values that especially the far right talks about. This is supposed to be those values. You talk about opposing welfare and opposing things that really aren't dominated by the African American community anyway. And you say, oh well, they want to be by themselves. We got rid of segregation. It's not segregation, it's independence. We celebrate it every July 4th, right? And some of us celebrate it as well on Juneteenth, which is June 19th. You know, we talked about that on the show as well. Mm-hmm. And I really think that more people, you know, not just the Pan-African community, but more people should give some credence to this because it's honestly, especially you mentioned that, you know, your middle school and your high school teacher didn't tell you everything about this holiday that was created and why this holiday is celebrated. But let's face the facts here, people. Especially after, you know, MGT, now the thing she just posted. All these holidays are made up. I'm sorry to bust your bubble, but none of these days are important. The world keeps turning. We're not even in the same space that we were in, you know? Yeah. And I mean this. If you built a time machine today, you tried to travel back in time, you're going to go into empty space because the planet, the solar system, the galaxy, the universe, it keeps moving. So that space that happened back then, it's in the past. Move forward. This is all about progression.
Don't you know that Saturnalia was a pagan holiday that everybody would just get really drunk and have sex with each other?
Yes, and the men would give gifts to the other men. I know. See, you know, what are you talking about? Saturnalia, the winter solstice, they're talking about Krampus, they're talking about any of the Norse beliefs or any of the other pagan holidays,
Babylonia. The Yule log.
We could talk about, you know, the Mayans, what they did around this time, but no, let's ignore that, you know. But what I'm trying to say here is just because something is new or something is unfamiliar to you, I'm going to say that again so you can, you know, read my lips if you're a little bit hard of hearing or if that pesky static likes to catch up. If something is unfamiliar to you, it does not make it bad or wrong. Do some research. Learn what it's about. It's not like, yeah, I get the opposition to Christmas and the opposition to Hanukkah that was originally garnered by some of the people who were involved in the creators, but their hearts were in the right place. It was literally in the right place. And in my opinion, please do not argue about this with other people. Like,
no, we had the same infighting when it came to Juneteenth. When Juneteenth became a national holiday, I was like, that's some bullshit because
I celebrated July 4th. Brother.
And then the infighting began.
I'll say it the best way that I possibly can. We said it earlier, and I know we restarted the show. If we're on the same team like you think we are, then don't have my baseball bats. I got to hit two.
No, you good.
I have to be able to hit if we're going to win this game.
No, we're on the same team, though. To play.
You know, I'm not here to run the bases. I'm here to put the ball over the fence.
No, we're going to pinch hit for you with someone who had a better training. Yeah, that's what's going to happen.
Hitter is my nephew.
You know, and I'm at the point where I don't understand. And like, and mind you, I'm someone who I really only care about facts. Literally, I really only care about facts. There are abject facts. There's, you know, true facts. There's the bottom line facts. There's alternative facts. I care about facts. And the fact of the matter is, after you heard, you know, a YT person, a YouTube person, mm-hmm. my friend Dutch over here, read off what Kwanzaa was about. And you're an American politician, which means you represent the American people. How you can use that? Is she one of those D-crats? Because I don't know a lot about her. So yeah. She reposted something. If you can bring that up again so everyone can see who may be joining.
I think, and just so you know, I went to pull up that tweet. I can't find it, so it looks like it's been deleted.
No, it's still I got you.
It is, because I'm on her Twitter.
You give us that, please.
I got you, homie.
I got you, I want to show y'all what I saw and what went through my head when I saw this. Okay, so I'm going to point this out. And this is a person that scrolls and scrolls and scrolls. Okay, so you have college Republicans who are posting about Happy Kwanzaa. Yeah, they spelled it wrong. Yes, they have the candles, a little bit awkward. It's more like the upside down menorah, which is not, it's supposed to be flat. It's fine. This person just called it a fake religion created by a psychopath. First of all, Kwanzaa is not a religion. Kwanzaa is a holiday. that's the original thing.
It's a religion. They're Kwanzish.
Yeah, Kwanzish. You know, Pan-African, which is, you can't even nail down a country, you know. Then you have, notice I said a country and not the continent, because there's lots of countries in Africa. That's why, and there's lots of, you know, displaced peoples all over the planet.
And Nigeria is the best.
You know, you said you aren't bringing in new voters, you're turning them away. People are tired of pandering in the BS. So then right there you see Congresswoman for Georgia. Oh, man, it would be Georgia, wouldn't it? You said Georgia or Florida. Christian wife, mom. Small business owner. It's gonna stay small now. You know, proud American.
Oh, that part's completely untrue. It's gonna get massive. They love it.
Pro Trump. Okay, so after someone reads to you the seven points of Kwanzaa, and someone explains to you what this is, you're telling me that you would post something like that. Let me explain. MGT, you are un-American. And anybody else who has those sentiments, you're also un-American. And I'm so tired of dichotomies and what's good for the goose is apparently hogwash for the gander. You know, this is BS. If you want to be able to believe freely what you want to believe and truly have your heart in it, then you have to stop thinking that you can trample all over the same exact freedom that Joe Jacker has. He can believe whatever he wants to. He can believe that, you know, he can wear tinfoil on his hat and think that flying saucers are kidnapping him every night and having wild space orgies. He can believe that if he wants to.
Yo, that we be hitting, though.
I'm not going to pass no legislation for the space orgy people. I'm not going to do it because it's asinine. And that's what this is. This is somebody who is just trying to get that shock reaction from, you know, the old school, the good old boy, the proud boy. I want just that reaction from because boy. They're different. They're different, so I'm going to attack them, even though I have no idea what the fuck I'm talking about.
But
that's what happens.
But that's popular. But that's popular, right? Like that's the thing now, is to do that. Is and much like Dutch made a video that we previously talked about, and you can check it out on patreon.com/digonamerica if you want to hear the full segment. She can do that. She can do this, which is kind of dog whistling hate speech if I've ever seen it. And it's going to get 6,000 likes. And Twitter has no problem. I bet if she made a YouTube video about it, she'd have no problem posting it. Yeah. But Twitter, if you call
regulated for the most part.
But if you call in to a place to disprove something someone's already saying, boom, gotcha, bitch. And now you're the bad guy. You're the guy spreading misinformation. So that's kind of where we're at. And as far as Kwanzaa goes, I was told when I was young that was a white people's religion that they tried to put on black people. I mean, now that I am the way I am and I believe what I believe and don't believe what I used to believe, I'm all about like the precepts of Kwanzaa are dope.
Yeah, I'd like to hear what. Go ahead. I'm sorry. I thought you were done.
Excuse me, White Wolf. I was still gesticulating.
Where's the fight?
the older and blacker I get, the more and more I love my people.
Wait, you getting blacker?
I'm going to.
Okay, so let me tell you a little some short.
Wait, I wasn't done yet.
I'm just piggybacking off of you. I got you.
All right, hold on. Give me a little space.
I got first piggy. I get first piggyback. Right.
I got a jelly roll. Right. I'm about to serve up. So like the older and blacker I get, the more I look around and not only do I empathize for my people, and I will always say my people, as much as I empathize, the more that I feel so encouraged, the more I feel by Dutch. Dutch just walked off screen because he couldn't listen to a black man talk about how much he liked black people. You a son of a bitch, Dutch. But it's, I understand that my journey and my path and my blackness is not congruent with everyone else's. And it took me a long time for me to be okay with it being a different path, right? Like it took me a long time. But now that I'm there, I now see that other people don't agree with my path or they feel a certain way about my path. Like I hear and see that now. And I accept it and I receive it. I'm like, all right, man, I get you. I'm not changing what I'm doing, but I hear what you're saying. And I love you anyway. Because unity, like all the seven precepts of Kwanzaa are something that every other fucking community has mastered. But as black people in this country, and I don't say African America, you can suck my fucking dick. I don't say African America. I'm black. You know what the fuck I'm talking about. You know what black means. Black means descendant of slave. That's what I'm talking about. Us black folk. The same seven precepts for Kwanzaa are so critical to my people moving forward because everyone else has mastered it and we refuse to accept and apply them to day-to-day life, which leaves us behind. So like let's take someone like a Kanye, right? Absolute person in fucking mental crisis who needs help. Like I don't want to bash the bro, but he definitely needs people to help him to get through what he's going through. But they will also buy Yeezys, which is owned by Adidas.
Yep.
We will so quickly step over our homie who has a small business, who's trying to make things pop, who's trying to get things happening. We will step over homeboy. So if you guys ever notice the t-shirts that I wear, do a little research behind the t-shirts I wear, and then call me a self-hating black. Do a little research. All the money that I spend on clothing is spent on black-owned businesses.
Yep.
And that is intentional. And it's by small people. That is intentional. It's by people I know. That is intentional.
And that, by the way, includes our gear.
Yeah, for sure.
Because like not
our
only
layout, our background is made by a small black-owned business. Independent yeah. young man working his ass off, fucking putting out flames. Like he fucking makes yeah. amazing shit. So I wish that I'm not the whole believer in Kwanzaa thing, but the principles of Kwanzaa, the precepts that it presupposes, are important to the black people. And all y'all black folk out there listening, it is important for us to spend money within our community. It is important for us to know our heritage. It is important to us to learn our history. It is important for us to take a day and love yourself for who you are. Love the journey that your body has been through. Like for you to be alive in 2021, there is, I don't know, God, how many generations has it been since the beginning of the fucking transatlantic slave trade? But there's 20 if you're a long last.
Yeah, well, or 400 times, you know, like
what's generation 5 years?
Be five years. Per 100 years. So whichever yeah. you know number you want to pick, 4 to 5 per 100 years. So you 16 have a, to 20.
And that you have an amazing legacy that you have no reason to be ashamed of. And don't let no history book or don't let no bullshit ass teacher make you feel ashamed that you're part of some of the most resilient, brilliant, just amazing people that have ever graced this planet. Wear that shit with fucking pride. And if Kwanzaa helps people understand that shit, fucking let's go. Kwanzaa on, motherfuckers. Let's go.
I got a couple things I want to throw in. So you
better throw them in then.
First of all, people who complain about this holiday, you know, and I know that I can't say that I even know any of my black friends who like go out and celebrate. Haas actually probably might, he's never said he does, but you know, like, but that's not the point. Like people who complain about it, generally complain that it's like, it's made up and you know, that's not, you know, that can't be part of your heritage because you don't know. Right. And every holiday is made up, but they'll say that, you know, that can't be your heritage. Cause you, how do you know where you were from? You know, how do you know you would have even spoke Swahili?
Bitches.
Well, but oddly enough, that's not even going to always tell you the whole story because what ends up happening historically speaking, is you had an entire, what did we just say, 20 generations of people who literally had their entire heritage taken away from them.
Yep.
They have no heritage beyond being here from 1619 until the 1830s when the slave trade was outlawed. Slavery continued, but the slave trade ended, I think, in like 1806 or something, if my history is a little foggy there, but early 1800s.
The transatlantic part of it, you know, they still were trading people here.
But the history begins really, you know, for those different generations of people brought here over those six generations or so during the slave trade, they have no heritage. Like you guys literally have no heritage. You cannot trace your lineage the way that I can.
It was systematically and supported by the government, ripped and stolen away from us.
Right. So, like, if you want to create Mikey Famine Day, go right the fuck ahead and do it. Because, you know, like, honestly, it's I should have nothing to say about that conversation. Now, there's another piece of this with Marjorie Taylor Greene or anyone who doesn't like this holiday. Like, there's some other tweets that I saw that are anti-Kwanzaa. It's funny that you guys select that holiday, but yet claim to be so colorblind. It's very convenient that that happens to be the case. It's very convenient that every time that there is a black movement, we call them psychopaths. Marjorie Taylor Greene used that exact phrase about the guy who created Kwanzaa. Now, he might have been a militant member of the Black Power movement. That does not make you a psychopath. Because the last that I checked, the people that tried to overthrow the Capitol on January 6th also were militant.
Black supremacists, all of them.
They were being militant about something fake, but yet the psychology is like exactly the same. They felt oppressed.
Did we not have an American Revolution?
Yeah, the American Revolution is another great example of that. And of course, Daily Wire wants to go out and say that any comparison between Black Lives Matter or the civil rights movements in general and the American Revolution are, that comparing them is disrespectful to actual patriots. Wrong. Okay, you're wrong. You're so wrong, because look, the American Revolution, the civil rights struggle, Black Lives Matter, etc. You know, Black Lives Matter and civil rights struggle are kind of the same thing. And the January 6th insurrection. All three of those things have the exact same group psychology. It's precisely the same. The source is not the same. January 6th is made up, but the psychology is the same. I feel something bad happened to me. I feel oppressed. I feel silenced. No one will listen to me. And eventually I turn to protest, and then after that I turn, because nothing else is working, now I get violent. That psychology is precisely the exact same thing. There is no difference, because we are humans. Human beings have human being group psychology. That's just the way that it happens to work. So I would love to know which principle of Kwanzaa that Marjorie Taylor Greene and the people who hate this holiday disagree with so much. Is it unity? Which one do you disagree with? Is it community? I'd love to know. Please tell me, because the last that I checked, I heard somewhere that facts don't care about my feelings. And I was convinced of it. I was convinced that it had to be accurate. I know I've said that before, and I'm going to say it again.
I want to bet a dollar to a donut that the same people that are tweeting about this also tweeted about Black History Month, also tweeted about Juneteenth.
Let me wrap it real quick. Every single movement, they take whoever started it, Patrice Cullors, the guy from Kwanzaa, the author of the 1619 Project, the Black Panther Party, every single one of the Black empowerment movements, they've taken the leader or leaders of that movement and demonized them as violent, psychopathic socialists. 100% of them. Name me one that they didn't.
Unity, self-determination, collective work and responsibility, cooperative economics, purpose, creativity, faith.
Sounds like socialism to me.
Sounds a lot like the Declaration of Independence.
What a psychopath.
We the people declare these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and the rest. And I'm going to hammer this home, because I wanted to comment on what Mikey said, and then I want to comment on what you said, because in essence, they're exactly the same. You have a situation here where you have people who were systemically oppressed, who you have a group of people who broke away from that and said, well, you know what, let's forget about everything else and worry about building on the future. So this is where we're going to start at. And then you have the people who say, well, you know what, that oppression, I'm used to that oppression. I like that oppression. And these people are dumb for trying to break up from the oppression. But here's the thing. I'm not about to sit here and watch the Good Times special in 2021 for New Year's Eve. I'm going to say, you know what are me and my buddies going to do? We're either going to shoot a show or we're going to go to work. and then we're going to move on, and we're going to teach our kids better. Because this world's not going to, this world might leave us behind, but it's not going to leave them behind. They have to grow up in it. And anyone that wants to take away from that holiday or this holiday, you guys are idiots. Those things don't exist anyway. What we're talking about is the principles that you end your year on, and you push for the next year. Those seven pillars right there, those things, those precipices, all those things will push any society to be better. And I'm sorry, we don't have enough Black-owned businesses. We don't have enough Black-owned banks. We don't have enough Black-owned entertainment. I'm telling you, it's a different mindset. And you know what? They made fun of us, but it's cool. That the Kwanzaa will stop that. Kwanzaa will get people to see this is not necessarily about the fat man in the suit. It's not about the guy that was on the cross or the baby in the manger. It's not about any of that. This is not about the wise men. This is not about Moses. No, this is not about religion. This is about community building. And if there's one thing that we need in the Black community, it's something to start with, something to build on. We can't keep going back to 1964 and walking the streets of Selma. We can't keep going back to that. We have to say, when do we move forward? When do we move to the future? When do we make the money? When do we invest into our businesses, into our people, into ourselves? When do we invest? And I'm trying to explain why Kwanzaa exists. Not the fact that Kwanzaa is a Black holiday. Kwanzaa is a community holiday to build upon for the future. It ain't got nothing to do with racism against white people. It ain't got nothing to do with no war on Christmas. It ain't got nothing to do with no Jesus. It ain't got nothing to do with no Santa Claus. And damn near ain't got nothing to do with no Easter Bunny neither. It ain't got nothing to do with none of that. It got nothing to do with no deities. It ain't got nothing to do with no pan, no tithes and offerings. It ain't got nothing to do with it. It's about investing into our children, our youth, ourselves, and bringing some real change to this community internally. I cannot have another Jay-Z versus Lil Wayne debate. I can't have it. Is Kanye crazy and he got invaded by aliens?
Let me ask you something real quick. In the Jay-Z versus Lil Wayne debate, who makes all the money?
Rick Rubin.
Thank you.
So here is, and I hate to come back to this, but here is the thing. Like for years, and you guys know this. I know this, and I'm not even Black. For years,
what?
Decades, you have heard. Yeah, I only look Black. I've heard from Republicans, conservatives. Let's not call them Republicans because Democrats are conservatives too. I've heard from conservative-minded people that reparations, no thanks. Social welfare, no thanks. BET, United Negro College Fund, all this stuff, affirmative action, no thanks. It's all unfair. It's all racist towards white people. Black on Black crime, you should fix your own community. That's the Black community's responsibility for them to fix their own community, not ours. That's what they keep telling me. So when I read through these principles, unity, to strive for and maintain unity in family and community, sounds like the Black community coming together. Self-determination, to define ourselves, name ourselves, create for ourselves, and speak for ourselves. Create for ourselves sounds like doing something on the grassroots level. Collective work and responsibility. I don't even need to go into that one. That's literally what they're talking about. Cooperative economics. Again, literally what they're telling you that you should do. Purpose, to make our collective vocation in the building and developing of our community. Again, literally another piece of building a community. Creativity, to leave our community more beautiful than we inherited it. Sounds familiar. Faith, to believe in our heart that our people, parents, teachers, and leaders, and the righteous victory of our struggle. Last I checked, people, parents, teachers, and leaders are part of a community. So therefore, every single aspect of this holiday is literally about the exact same thing that people like Marjorie Taylor Greene will tell you. That's your own problem. Figure out black on black crime on your own. Figure out black community economics on your own. Figure out inner city economics on your own. But when you do it,
I'm a shit on it.
Nope, it's just more radical. It's from a leftism, psychopath, dangerous, or in the case of Patrice Cullors, a lesbian witch. Yep. Socialist. Like they gave her the triple
socialist. Even the Martin Luther King Jr. stuff that's going around the last couple of years. You know, I'm gonna say this. Y'all who claim to be red-blooded Americans are all about freedom and the bald eagles and America and all that. You should be fucking ashamed of yourselves for ever coming against anything that's about building this country and making this country better. And I'm going to tell you, the people, now, Dutch, this is not an affront or mean, but you know what?
I feel offended.
Most of your people age like avocados, you know what I'm saying? You know, and that's just the truth about it. You have people.
Well, avocados are delicious.
Yeah, but they don't last very long. You know, they burn out. You know, you walk outside for 5 minutes and you have to go to, you know, surgeons for the next 20 years, you know. And I'm saying let us who have the ability to do. And the reason I say let is because I am under no illusions that there is not a machine that's been at work for a long time. I'm under no illusions that the control that's needed to sway a particular group of people in a direction is the keys. The keys are not in me and Mikey's hands. Me and Mikey have the information on how the keys work, but we cannot get in the car and turn the car on and drive the car because the car happens to be sitting in someone else's garage. So when people like MGT talk about this type of stuff, that's the car sitting in her garage. She knows the car is in her garage, so she's going to say whatever she wants to say. You don't need a holiday to do this. Okay, cool, that's fine. I'm going to walk into the bank. I need a $15,000 loan because I have an amazing idea for this store in the hood. The store is going to change everything about how we shop in the hood, and that way I can pay back this loan because they're going to spend their money here. Now, why don't they just go to Walmart? We built a Walmart out there. See what I'm talking about? This is not a situation of – that's why I say it's just a bit deeper – than what color I was born. You know, so just a bit deeper than that, but people don't want to acknowledge. And then you have them other skinned folk who say the same thing. I'm not about to order from your candle company. I'm about to go to Bath and Body Works. Why? Because I could walk in Bath and Body Works and walk back out. You know, we earlier had a politician that was talking about bringing back, you know, a lot of grassroots things, which I'm all for. There's only one problem with that. Bezos. If I want a graphics card or something like that, I have a better chance of catching it on Amazon than I do checking it on Branch Hub or anything like that. You know what I'm saying? There needs to be people that understand that I can't get better without funding. I can go as far as I can go on my own. That's the truth about anything. And look at your professional athletes. They can go as far as they can on their own. They get agents. They get trainers. They have off-season camps. They have people that monitor their biorhythms. Your favorite athlete has about 50 people managing him in every different way. He got people for his legs, people for his arms, people for his back, his eyes, his neck, his nose. You know, me being an athlete, I can tell you on a much smaller level that I have all those people today. So imagine what they have. And so you can't say, well, you guys know this already. Build it yourself. Well, that's great. You know, the guys over there, they have those
books. Get the fuck out of the way then.
You know, that's what I'm saying. Get out the way. Stop talking about it. You want me to do better for my community? Stop trying to pass legislation that stops me from doing so. You want me to do better for my community? You stop posting about this so your people who could barely read anyway can jump on board and they see me walking around with my necklaces on and you know, my bands on and his shirt, you know, and you giving facts about what's really going on, Dutch. Stop shouting these people down. Don't boycott the Black Panther movie because it shows rich Africans doing rich African stuff in a place that doesn't exist. Krypton don't exist either. I don't know if y'all knew this. you know, Superman been around for 80 years, but Krypton is not a real place, and stop. There's no such thing as, you know,
what?
I'm just keeping it real. So it doesn't exist, you know? That's why Peter Parker is the only one clad from head to toe in some boy shorts and spandex, because the creators was thought about, man, you know what? What if he could be anybody? We did that with the Black Panthers. You mentioned that, Dutch. We had the Black Panthers. What they do? Gun control laws. What was the loitering and all these other things? Mm-hmm. You can't run a daycare without certain permits. And guess who owns the permits? You can't give out food anymore because it's unsanitary. You can't do education because you don't have an education license. You know, these are things that sound good as far as infrastructure go, but these things were not designed to make the place better or safer. These things were designed to stop people from getting ahead.
Yeah, and that's the danger that you just brought up there, is that I know some people probably tuned into this video to hear about Kwanzaa, and you are. But it's deeper than just December 26th through January 1st. So Black Panther, the movie, was boycotted because people said, oh, Marvel is promoting the evil Black Panther organization.
You're welcome.
Right? So it's, you know, they're promoting an evil terrorist group of people, they said. And boycotted the movie with knowing nothing about it, knowing nothing about the fact that the Black Panthers were, I forget it was Navy or Air Force, but a group of black pilots that the comic book and Fred Hampton's group named their organizations both after. Well, in the case of Stan Lee, named the comic book after. But they don't think about that. Because words have meaning to them, and that meaning, that's the brilliance of the Republican marketing strategy, is they'll use words, and that's why they win. This is why they're winning, because Joe Schmo in the middle, right? Like your general, totally non-racist, at least not explicitly. You know, might have some biases. Of course, everybody does. White family that lives in, like, you know, Naperville or whatever town you want to, you know, Jackson, Mississippi, whatever town you want to throw out there. I don't care.
Town, Colorado.
Yeah, Austin, Texas is probably a great example of this. You know, they don't pay attention. Republican marketing strategies like war on crime sound really sensible. Why would you want crime? Why would a sensible person like drugs? Of course we should have a war on drugs. Why shouldn't we regulate daycares? Of course we want to protect kids. Why shouldn't we do? And all of these things are set up systemically. Holy shit, sounds like we should be teaching this in school. Oh, that's right. They don't want that. Critical race theory, 1619 project.
The Willie
Black History Lynch Month. Letter. Yeah, like even Black History Month, it triggers people. But like the left does it wrong, right? They come up with terms like defund the police instead of like reinvigorate or reimagine policing, you know. But like that's not about that. It's about the fact that the right is brilliant with their marketing of hatred. And it sounds so reasonable to people in the middle. People on the right know exactly what it is, but they get to advertise it as, what are you talking about? What's wrong with a war on crime? You like crime? This guy likes crime. Squirrel, squirrel.
I can't argue with idiots anymore. If they don't know the difference, that's not my problem.
You can't.
They never listen to nuance. But the problem is, though, that the people in the middle who don't pay attention, they're not the idiots. And that's like when I was talking about before about going into these spaces.
But they are idiots, Dutch. That's the trick question of it. It's either you're an idiot. It's a pass fail situation. Either you know what you're talking about or you don't. They don't know what they're talking about. If you can literally stand in the middle of Black Lives Matter versus Blue Lives Matter, and you think both sides equally have a stance in it, then you've missed the point. And there's no point in talking to you. You're dumb. You're an idiot. You don't know what you're talking about.
But the perception of someone in the middle, and I'm using that term loosely here. It's probably not the best term to use.
Well, there are people in the middle. It's the correct term.
But those people are not stupid. Okay? I'm going to tell you right now, those people are not stupid because a lot of these people come...
They're unswayed. And the thing about it is, if I can scare you...
No. It's not that they're unswayed. It's that they're swayed by things that seem reasonable to them.
If you don't have critical thinking, I can scare you, then I can sway you. If you don't have critical thinking to discern the truth out of matters, then you're dumb.
Well, that action is dumb, but that doesn't mean necessarily that the person is, because if you look at the whole situation, most people, and now this is a dumb thing, but most people do not read the whole article, right? They read the headline. So that's why the headline, the people who write the headlines are trying to get the clicks, or in the old days, get you to buy the paper. When someone looks at the title and they say, okay, the title is going to be reflective of the content, you don't have to go into the content and explain away the content because the title has already sold the whole story to most people. Is that a stupid way to do things? Yes, but that's the way that most people do it. And that is not a race thing. It's not a socioeconomic thing either.
Over 100 years.
It's been that way. It's been done that way for thousands of years by multiple different governments and kingdoms, monarchies, etc. That's just the way it's done.
Your populace. It's right. Like this, man. If I told you, and I'm going to make this up, so this is not a fact, guys. This is an illustration. If I told you that if you drink red Kool-Aid, you're not going to be able to have children anymore, and you're a single man with no children, no wife, and you think, oh, I want to have a kid. I want to have somebody carry on my legacy. Doesn't matter if it's a girl or a boy, you know, or anything in between. It doesn't matter. But if I told you that if you drink red drinks, it's going to mess you up. And then you have a quote unquote expert that came and said, I drank red drinks for 20 years. You see, I have no children. That they're going to say, okay, well, you know, that's the evidence right there. So you say, okay, well, this person, why do you think they discredit the victim immediately when something happens? Because as soon as I introduce something that it might not even be related to anything that happened today, I can sway your opinion because you were in the middle. I can sway your opinion pretty easy. It works wonders to sway people's opinions when they're in the middle. You don't have
the ones that listen. The ones that listen, and a lot of them will, but that's the thing. And that's the thing I was getting at before, is if you get the chance to engage that middle person, 9 out of 10 times, I personally, and I think Cortez even too, has been able to make at least a little bit of headwind with them. And in a lot of ways, they are semi-innocent bystanders. Because when we grew up, we didn't say, well, we have to be politically engaged. You just went to they told us to vote. They never told us in school to study politics.
They didn't tell us why.
We didn't even know what we were voting for. You just voted like your parents.
My favorite hip hop artist / rapper, and only a few people even know this, his name is Lupe Fiasco, right?
I love Lupe Fiasco.
He used a term about this particular situation in our community. It's called malleable. Malleable is an interesting term because malleable doesn't mean to create. Malleable means to change what's already there and shape it. So the people that we reach out to, that we try to change, the people that we try to introduce facts to in a different viewpoint, those people are malleable. They're able to be molded into whatever we want to mold them into. Those people from January 6th, those people were malleable. They truly believed in what they had been told, not because they had actual facts, but because someone molded this carefully over 3.5 years, that they just molded this and they told them this every single day. They heard it being beat through their ears, through their cars, through people's hats, people's clothing, social media pages. They were molded into these pawns. And you get enough pawns, you get enough lemmings together, they're going to start toppling stuff. And they tried it. It just wasn't enough of them. And they got a lot done, And because of the way that the laws favor the people that were there and the way they use them, like what we talked about earlier, when you might not have done anything, but the way that things are set up, it doesn't favor you anymore. It does not favor you to tell the truth. It does not favor you to put out the actual facts, because there's all of these people who know how to manipulate and mold what's already there. Yes, KRS. Yes. That's what we get.
Go ahead, read the comment.
That's the catch. Though it wasn't just over 3 years, they've been getting primed for this their whole lives. What did you say? The first thing you said when we restarted this was, my high school teacher misrepresented these facts.
Did not tell me
about this. A lot of things that he said were not true. So in your formative years, if you were not a quote unquote critical thinker to say, I'm going to Google this, or I'm going to go pick up a book about this, or I'm going to ask my boy who's wearing Jamaican colors, you know, not everybody does that. Like you said, the headline, they catch that headline. They see Ms. West divorces Mr. West. They don't see nothing in between. It's all they saw. And they go tell their friend, and their friend go tells their friend. And then they have that one friend, the conspiracy theorist, that's going to give you a whole story that he just concocted. And now we're going to push that out to everybody. And now I don't have to give this narrative anymore, because you understand where I'm going with this. Once you can mold what's already there to make a shape and look what you want it to look like, you got them. Because now you have, not to go religious, because I'm not, but you have an idol. And you can worship this idol, that's this fake thing that somebody created. And now it's a thing. And the longer it goes on, the more they think that's the fact.
Yeah. And they've been, all of us actually, have been socially conditioned to believe things that, you know, to believe certain things, like in the white community, the great one, police are there to protect you, right? Like, so I had, my son is autistic, okay? And he's half Hispanic, half white, my little one. He's 5 years old, nonverbal autistic. And he talks a little bit, but not a lot. And he works with a young lady from Easter Seals, Hispanic girl, super awesome, wonderful occupational therapist. And she says things like, what is a teacher? And my son is supposed to repeat the phrase, or what does a teacher do? Works at the school. What does mommy do? You know, mommy protects me. One of the lines is, what does a doctor do? When do you see the doctor? When I'm sick. What does a policeman do? Policemen protect me. So like, now my son is unable to really do this yet. He's working on it. But the goal is to get him to say these things. Now, I was brought up to believe that the police protect as well. And my experience has been that the police have done that for the most part in my situation. Okay. Now, but my situation is not universal. There is different communities that have different life experiences than the ones that I have come to perceive as true based on my experiences. Right? Like I've had cops be complete dicks to me, but I never felt at risk. So the idea that a police officer might, like, that your life would be in fear, you'd be in fear for your life, to most people in the middle, and I'm using that term again, is an unfathomable idea until they start to be exposed to actual real history and facts. And those are the things that it turns out, because, and this is why I feel so strongly about this. Mikey, I get that you disagree, and that's fine. But in a lot of these spaces, in a lot of these Twitter groups and a lot of these Facebook groups, there are people who have been told it's sensible to look at both sides. They look on both sides. They see us say vaccines protect you. They look at the other side. The other side says that look at this website, vaccines kill.
That's cool.
And they think bridges, they're looking at both bridges, sides.
I got bridges to sell each and every one of them.
Except the problem is, Mikey, though, that you and I don't have a bridge. because we're not trying to manipulate them.
There's also not two sides to every argument. Like, that's the thing. Like, if these people are so stupid,
well, not two right sides.
There aren't two sides. Just because you think you have an opinion on a matter that is contrary to what a particular group might believe, that doesn't give you validation. That doesn't make it right. That doesn't make it real. There's motherfuckers running around talking about the earth is flat. They don't get a fucking platform on NASA. NASA doesn't have a flat earth expert on retainer. For what? You're wrong, you dumbass. Get the fuck out of here. The adult, like, it is, my generation is the generation of the adults have work to do. Well, I had time to be playing around with your fucking bullshit ass fucking theories and postulations. If you don't have shit to fucking bring to the table, there are coloring books and Crayolas. There are colored pencils and markers. We couldn't afford the crayons. You guys just eat them. But there's a table for the children who refuse to engage in critical thought. If you don't want to fucking engage in critical thought, then sit your little dumb ass down on the fucking sidelines. We got fucking work to do. We got handed a fucking shit show by the previous generation who is still to this day refusing to leave the workforce and still to this day refusing to take responsibility for their fucking careless and idiotic fucking behavior. So we have to clean up their shit. We have to get our shit together and we have to raise our shells. So we don't really have time for all this. So if you don't have no fucking information, go get your coloring book and go sit your ass down. Please and thank you.
All right, you can take us home.
We're going home. I'm fucking sick. Sick of all this shit.
Who are we? How can they find us?
Well, everybody, if you are in a financial position to help out the show, please go to patreon.com/digonamerica. Every little pledge helps, and every pledge helps get us towards our $100 goal, in which we will give 1/3 of our proceeds to a charity that has been picked out by our patrons. If you are not in a financial position, you can check out our website, www.digonamerica.com. Follow us on Twitch, twitch.tv/DOA podcast, or follow us on YouTube or Twitter @DigOnAmerica.